Costa Rica. Rich coast is what Columbus named this country. Not knowing how much coast it really had, or what constituted its true riches. Costa Rica's true wealth is life itself. On less than 1% of the planet's surface, 7% of all species of plant and animal life are gathered together here. Fruitful soil and a virtual paradise climate make Costa Rica an overabundantly blessed and wonderfully habitable piece of land between the two Americas. Immediately adjoining the Isthmus of Panama, Costa Rica is part of the land bridge that connects the geologically more ancient continents of the northern and southern hemispheres, and at the same time separates two mighty oceans. From the vantage point of Costa Rica's mountain peaks, the panorama extends from the Atlantic to the Pacific. Costa Rica is one of the greenest patches on our blue planet. From the mango groves along the coast to the damp, misty forests on the flanks of the volcanoes, dense tropical forests cover two-thirds of this country to this day. Gradually, these forests are proving to be the real riches of Costa Rica. Proportionally speaking, Costa Rica has the greatest number of nature reserves and national parks of any country on Earth. Even though preservation laws are often violated, Costa Rica is opening its green treasures to visitors from North America, Europe, and more often from its own cities in innovative, sustainable, and even very profitable ways. The idea of spanning the crowns of the majestic rainforest trees with a network of cables to travel along originated with scientific research workers. It enabled them to gently and efficiently observe life in the treetops. Ecotourism managers were inspired by the possibilities. This is nothing for your average tourist. You have to be at least a bit of an adventurer and an ecotourist at heart to shout with joyful glee and not abject terror as you fly through the treetops along a thin cable 50 to 60 meters above the forest floor. The technique originated in the Alps, where alpine farmers as well as tourism operators have been using all kinds of cable cars and cableways for decades. Austrian biologists brought the technique with them from home and began using it to swing from one rainforest giant to another like Tarzan. And yet, there are still unexplored areas which can only be reached by foot and explored from the ground. The bird paradise, Monte Verde National Park, is no longer a rainforest secret. Thus, this nature reserve is still a worthwhile research destination. For example, for ornithologists looking for the shy quetzal, Costa Rica's national bird. A young gray fox shows no signs of timidity. Even Costa Rica's insect world testifies to astounding biodiversity. Even to this day, researchers come across previously unknown types of insects in the misty forests. The plants and animals of the forest get the water they need for survival not from rain, but from the mist. The fog that rolls in from the coast and condenses in the tree crowns without falling as rain. Thank you. green vine snake on the hunt. For a moment, the Central American gray squirrel looks like a suitable prey. But upon closer examination, the mammal proves to be a size too big for this snake, which grows to a maximum length of only 2 meters. But now, the green vine snake has a bite-sized prey in its sights. It is a gladiator frog. The small snake has no poisonous fangs, but its fangs are bent inward in such a way that even though the frog is virtually uninjured and inflates itself, every effort it makes to escape simply forces it further down the snake's throat. Huge amounts of dew settle on the gigantic leafy surfaces of the trees and continuously drips to the ground so that the springs and streams never run dry. This abundance of moisture is a never-ending gift of the two nearby oceans. Thanks to the high humidity, over 600 types of epiphytes grow in the crowns of the trees. The roots of these plants never reach the ground. So-called microponds form wherever funnel-shaped flowers and leaves collect water. The poisonous dart frog seeks out these reservoirs to lay its eggs. One of the 50 types of hummingbird that inhabits Costa Rica. One more brilliantly iridescent than the next. But it still isn't the quetzal. But this time, its call sounded promisingly close. And here he is, a fabulously colored male. As long as the birds remain motionless in the tree branches, they are perfectly camouflaged. But when the quetzal begins feeding, in the favorite part of its territory, the crowns of the trees break into motion. The quetzal feeds only during certain times of the day. It holds itself so exactly to that schedule that one can set their watch by it. Today, the quetzal's habitat is limited to the steep mountain forests. For centuries, small farmers and large plantation owners have cleared off areas of level and easily accessible rainforest. Gradually, settlements developed around the cultivated areas. But here, on the edge of the Monte Verde National Park, civilization is held in check. Small, unobtrusive banana and coffee plantations fit almost harmoniously into the nearly untouched wilderness. Coffee was first brought to Costa Rica from Egypt at the end of the 18th century. But already in the 19th century, the country was exporting the best coffee in the world. Costa Rica and coffee were made for each other. The volcanic soil found throughout the country has acidity which is perfect for growing coffee. That, combined with the unique tropical climate, almost an island climate, between two oceans, makes Costa Rica the best coffee cultivation area in the world. But even these ideal coffee growing conditions would have remained ineffective if Costa Rica had not had the most ambitious coffee roasters in the world. comparable to top-class winemakers in the world of wine. Thanks to coffee exports, the country was modernized early on. For the last half century, and up to the present day, it is one of the oldest and most stable democracies in Latin America. 2.4 million sacks of coffee per year provide the country with 30% of its export income, but at the same time make it vulnerable to price fluctuations on the commodities markets. If Costa Rica is the world's market leader as far as the quality of its coffee is concerned, it leads in quantity with another of its fruits. Just imagine a kilometer-wide strip stretching the 500 kilometers between Cologne, Germany and Paris, France. That is about the area taken up by banana cultivation along the Atlantic coast of Costa Rica. Monoculture banana cultivation doubled between 1985 and 1992, mostly at the cost of the inland rainforests. The banana originally came from Southeast Asia. Immigrants from that region brought it to Africa. From there, it journeyed to the Canary Islands, among other places. Portuguese settlers brought it from there to the Latin American region in the 16th century, where the Spaniards began to cultivate the fruit. Costa Rica is still very much characterized by its agriculture, with many small farmers who either use their produce themselves or sell it at local markets. In the meantime, however, the proportion of agricultural activity is decreasing steadily. Taking its place are young high-tech industries and growing tourism. In any case, the next generation of ticos, which is what the inhabitants of Costa Rica call themselves, is more likely to find themselves working in the hotel branch or the computer industry than on the fields or plantations. And they will probably rarely do their shopping at the colorful market of Cartago, the old capital of the country, where the local farmers offer their produce fresh off the fields. They are more likely to shop in air-conditioned supermarkets of large, modern cities like San Jose. In the competition between Costa Rica's numerous national parks, the Manuel Antonio Park on the Pacific coast takes first place without a doubt. Thousands of hermit crabs populate the beaches here. Hermit crabs have a soft body and thus need to borrow an appropriate snail shell to protect themselves. As the crab grows, its house becomes too small, and he needs to move to a bigger dwelling. On the opposite side of the land bridge, the rainy season has begun in the Tortuguera National Park. Costa Rica has only two seasons, wet and dry. In nearly all of Costa Rica, rain always falls in the summer. It normally rains for only part of the day, either in the afternoon, during the evening, or at night, depending on the distance from the coast. A dripping wet, two-fingered sloth might present a picture of abject misery, and the smell of its wet fur does nothing to dispel that impression. But in fact, the animal enjoys the daily shower and seems to be far more active now than in the steaming humidity of the hot and no less moist jungle. On the Golfo Papagayo, or Parrot Gulf, on the Pacific coast, not too many young turtles hatch out of the nests in the sand anymore. The five types of turtle found in Costa Rica are all endangered, primarily because their eggs, meat, and shells bring in good money. As soon as the little leatherback sea turtles hatch, they all dash for the relative safety of the ocean in a desperate race to escape predators such as dogs, pelicans, other birds of prey, and humans. They are guided by light. The forested inland side of the beach is dark, while the ocean side is light. Whitewashed houses along the coast can confuse the animals and entice them to head in the wrong direction and thus to their death. If they manage to reach the water, the most dangerous phase of their lives is over. But no place is entirely free of danger in nature's wilderness. Both on the Pacific and Atlantic side, the mountain forests have been losing ground to farm and grazing land for a long time. This has destroyed natural habitat for many animals outside the nature reserves. Animals such as the coati, a scavenger who eats almost anything and lives on the ground as well as in the trees. Coatis settle in the most diverse landscapes, from rainforests to the dry woods on the few outcroppings which remain untouched by both rainfall and fog. And as long as they are not mistreated, they get used to humans quite easily, like here at the entrance of the Monte Verde National Park. The pioneer days of Costa Rica date back to 1502 when Columbus explored this area, which is thought to have been inhabited for the past 11,000 years. From 1560 on, the country was systematically colonized and Christianized. Because of its few raw materials and its lack of strategic importance, the colony remained an unimportant appendage of the Spanish crown. The Cathedral of Cartago, Nuestra Señora de los Angeles, Our Lady of the Angels, is Costa Rica's national holy place, a famous pilgrimage destination. Thousands come here to give thanks to the Virgin Mary for miraculous help they have received in times of need, or to pray for healing or deliverance from their sufferings. In the middle of Cartago, ruins of the old cathedral stand under protection as national monuments and remind one of the many earthquakes that have rocked the country in the past. One of the churches has been rebuilt 5 times. The Red Lord Amazon, a type of parrot, has adjusted to civilization particularly well. They are as common in the cities as pigeons are in Europe. The country owes its great fertility to its moist tropical climate on the one hand, and on the other to the fact that volcanic ash and rock spewed out by eruptions weather quickly in this climate, resulting in mineral-rich soil. Costa Rica has 7 large volcanoes, 6 of them dormant, but none of them are sleeping very deeply. The stillness of the poison green-colored sulfurous lake in the crater of the 3,500-meter-high Irazo volcano could be misleading. One can tell that the crater landscape of the Poás volcano is simply dozing at best. Every 40 years or so, it has awoken for a time and become unsettled, but never as violently as Costa Rica's only currently active volcano, the Arenal. In 1968, after being dormant for 400 years, it erupted with devastating violence and has been spewing lava and ash every day since. It is among the planet's 10 most active volcanoes. Also along the coast, the fiery origins of the country are not to be overlooked. Lava cliffs characterize the beaches and the underwater landscapes, providing inhabitants with a thousand-fold diversity of living environments. The ecotourism, which is already flourishing in the misty forests on the slopes of the volcanoes, is beginning to take hold here as well. Word is getting around in diving circles that the warm waters off the Caribbean coast and the currents of the Pacific, which are often cold, offer impressive spectacles of natural beauty. About equidistant from both coasts, on the high plateau Valle Central, lies the capital city, San Jose. With a little over 300,000 inhabitants, it is not exactly a metropolis, but if it keeps on growing at its current rate, it could soon become one. Its population has increased sixfold over the past five decades. Thanks to its elevation of nearly 1,200 meters, San Jose has a pleasant climate all year round. Its international airport and its location right in the center of Costa Rica make the city a natural hub for tourism. Nothing stirs the emotion of the Ticos as much as the victory or defeat of its various soccer teams. And there are more teams here per 100,000 inhabitants than anywhere else in the world. When a local team like this one gets to play against the national team, it is fiesta time for the fans. Watching the round ball stir the emotions of the crowd, one can perhaps imagine the excitement which captivated the masses thousands of years ago during the ritual ball games. Back then, the games were played to the death. The treasures in the Gold Museum of San Jose, the national shrine to the highly developed pre-Columbian culture of Costa Rica, echo those ancient times. A people who brought the arts of agriculture, ceramics, and goldsmithing to Costa Rica 2,500 years ago, the Corotecas, created these valuable artifacts. They had fled south out of Mexico to escape slavery, only to have their culture finally fall prey to Spanish colonization. When Columbus, on his fourth Atlantic crossing in 1502, saw the precious jewelry of the coast dwellers, he mistakenly concluded that there must be an abundance of gold in the land. But Costa Rica is not rich in gold. The Corotegas themselves were very wealthy thanks to the fruitfulness of the land, but the greater part of their gold was imported from other places. Through Columbus's telescope, these coasts with their rivers must have looked about the same as they do today. Since then, the tropical forests have thinned, and the approximately 60,000 indigenous inhabitants of Costa Rica, who speak six different established languages, have long since become a small minority. And yet, the flow of daily life of simple country folk is probably not significantly different from that which Columbus and his crew experienced on their first treks through the coastal woodlands. The indígenas who live on the Guillermo Diosas Reservation in the Corcovado National Park secure a small income from the artistic handcrafts they produce for the tourist market. And yet their lifestyle is reminiscent in many ways of a life close to nature in which hunting and gathering alongside small-scale agriculture have not completely disappeared. The harvest of wild fruits from the forest is still as much part of the menu as are the fruits and tubers of ancient cultivated plants, which are mostly unknown in other parts of the world. There are more than 150 different edible fruits in Costa Rica, and certainly just as many types of vegetables. Some are only known to the indígenas. The high starch but low protein powder from dried and ground inox roots is cooked into a mash, similar to mashed potatoes. It can also be baked into bread. Today's indígenas still have this form of harvest in common with other so-called natural peoples of the rainforest also. Anything growing in the crowns of the trees can only be reached using remote harvesting techniques. Technology and material used for thousands of years, some dating back to the Stone Age, coexist with modern tools and materials in this hut, built according to the traditional pattern. The culinary traditions of the local inhabitants were of the greatest of interest to Columbus, because the spice trade promised as much profit as gold. He sent entire shiploads of local spices to Spain. Of all of Costa Rica's national parks, the Tortuguera Park on the east coast probably best fulfills the longing of the European visitor for a tropical jungle adventure. Just like Corcovado, this area is also, in many respects, an Amazon jungle in miniature format. Constantly foraging for ripe fruit, birds' nests, and small prey, spider monkeys are always on the move in the crowns of the trees. The squirrel monkey, which only grows to be about the size of a squirrel, was spread over broad areas of South America by pre-Columbian Indians. The monkeys were a very popular house pet. Today, both types are endangered by the loss of habitat and illegal animal trading. Anyone hiking through the jungle must remain constantly alert. All sorts of poisonous animals, insects, spiders, and snakes are everywhere. Rainforests like these in Costa Rica can be found in many parts of South America. Here, however, responsible authorities have long since recognized that these ecosystems require special protection. Isolating parts of this last paradise from the uncontrolled influence of mankind reveals a high level of awareness of our responsibility today for generations yet to be born in the future.